Yo, Pete Rich, you won the giveaway from last week's video. Enjoy your Trendings comics list.
All right, it's Morphin time.
Power Rangers!
What's good, comic fam? Another week, another list of the trending comics in the comic book market, and I'm at the table with an Overstreet Price Guide advisor. He's gonna help me go through this stuff. We got Russ Bright.
Comic book fam, you know what excites the heck out of me?
Touching expensive paper.
Hit that subscribe button. Let's jump into the list at number 10 before Russ starts sweating, comic fam. X-Men, Ten of Swords. We have creation number one. The Walmart exclusive. We're seeing $18 average sales. We're seeing a high sale. We're going to put this at $30. There is a $40 sale, but that could be an outlier. Seems a little aggressive when you can buy them right now for under $30. How do you feel about this Walmart exclusive spiking?
So, Tom, the spirit of these Walmart variants is really to get the comic books out to the people who don't have an LCS. And for that, I think that's a great idea. I wish that more Walmarts could get them, and I wish that there was more availability because they are just too scarce.
Pretty cool to see an opportunity of the hunt be introduced to kind of mainstream society. We're seeing individuals who don't have an opportunity to go digging in long boxes getting lucky at Walmarts with these multi-packs, sometimes having high-grade ones in there, variants from bigger cover artists, and this wraparound cover is gorgeous. So it makes sense why it's selling a little bit higher, but be careful about the spec because we haven't actually seen any one of these potential new characters slash show speculation pay off yet for any one of these Walmart comics.
So a lot of these Walmart specs are not necessarily driven because of anything concrete. For example, we have the Strange Academy number one that was selling in a 9.8 for $250, and now it can be had 2 months later for only $150. That's a hefty crash.
We also have that Spider-Verse 1 that features Billy Morales, Spider-Zero, debuting on the cover for the first time and on the inside. But that printing saw heights of similar proportions, 265, and recently selling now at 9.8 for $89. So you just have to be really careful. I think it's cool to hunt. I think it's great to get it on the cheap. But going for those 9.8 specs may not be the best route to go with these books.
So coming in at number 9, now this is a book that Tom and I think you should be excited about. Fantastic Four Antithesis number 2, the Alex Ross Timeless Variant.
Average sales of $15. We're seeing a high CGC 9.8 go for $200, only to be outmatched by the Sketch 1 in 100 variant. Alex Ross killed it for this entire collection, and I think it's undervalued right now.
Well, part of the issue is that there were 30, 31, 32 different covers of Alex Ross. And I know a lot of people who wanted every single cover. Some are more popular than others, but this Silver Surfer happens to be a key because you're also seeing the first appearance of the Anti-Monitor in issue number 2 of Fantastic Four Antithesis. So you've got a key book as well as an incredible, incredible variant cover.
Oh, a double key? This is what I love to talk about, especially because I feel like we're going to have another repeat of a surprise across the community that they had this last year with the hip-hop variants. Those Marvel hip-hop variants were going for what? Under $6? 90% of them? Maybe more? For years. Only to spike to all new grounds. And this collection is gorgeous together, and I think people are going to be hunting for it long term.
Well, you can also keep in mind that some of these variants, like the Thor and the Venom, were made in massive quantities because you do have people buying a bunch of them. Something like the Fantastic Four miniseries, you didn't have as many people buying. So you have incredible Alex Ross art coupled with the relative scarcity compared to the other Marvel books coming out. Not everyone could pick up every single one of these Alex Ross covers off the stands.
Seeing an increase in copies sold of over 160%, it made me have to go look and see what we had in the giveaway box. We do have This is actually issue number 3 of the same run, isn't it?
I know, so close. But yes, in issue number 3 of Fantastic Four Antithesis, this is the 1 in 100 Timeless Sketch variant. And we have one for you if you like, subscribe, and comment down below.
Medusa looking so dope on this variant. Comment down below. It'll enter you to win this comic book. And I want to know what your favorite variant is from this Alex Ross collection.
So nostalgia is driving sales all over the place. And the 80s kids really are all over this list. Number 8 in the list, Punisher number 1 from 1987. I cannot tell you how many times I have a collection come in that this book is in, and this book is spiking and it is moving fast this week.
$15 average sales for this comic book with the, you know, 9.8 hovering around the $100 mark, with 9.6s approaching fast. And this comic book is so dope because it's kind of unique in the fact that it is a key. It's the first Punisher ongoing series. Mm-hmm. It's a key moment for this character. He got his own title. But it's not his first solo series. That happened a year prior in 1986. Issues 1 through 5 are coveted, and that issue 1 really gets the attention of most collectors, does it not? It sells a lot more.
But you have to keep in mind that the Punisher number 1 from the limited series is a little bit thicker book, so it's going to be condition sensitive. Getting a 9.8, it really justifies how much it has spiked. A month ago, you could get a 9.8 in the $400, $450 range. This last week, $524 high sale. That's a fast mover.
Such aggressive sales there leads this other option for individuals who want a really cool Punisher number 1, but don't want to spend 5 times the amount for a 9.8.
So nostalgia can drive a whole lot of these things, and that's probably the reason why this book is selling 2 times as many copies as it did the week before. Now, there's not anything concrete news-wise, but there's speculation that since the Netflix contracts are supposedly expiring soon, we may very well see a season 3 on Disney+.
Next at the list at number 7, we have McFarlane goodness, Neil Gaiman goodness.
Oh, yeah.
Issue number 9 of Spawn, and I love this very tough cover in high grade. That white cover gets me every time, but man, I know this comic book well.
Oh, it's a beautiful book. It's really something that every single time I see it, I want to set aside this book. But yeah, that white cover has just the bane of my collecting existence for years.
First appearance of Angela seeing a lot of attention this week. $12 average sales. High sales for this book at 9.8 remain to be around $100 for the very condition-sensitive reasons that we just described. But this comic has seen an increase in copies sold of 129% after a casting call for Thor: Love and Thunder was released.
So there's a casting call for a strong female supporting character in her 20s to 30s named Artemisia, who would be Thor's half-sister. Now, don't put any faith in the names they put in these casting calls, because a lot of times it's just a smokescreen.
Didn't even notice that this cover was an homage to Wonder Woman 72. You got the shield on there and all.
Great Brian Boland cover, yeah.
Keep an eye out for that barcode comic, fam. The newsstand variants for Spawn has been surprising collectors pretty much every single week.
Oh,
and
yeah,
this book with the newsstand is seeing average sales of $50. But that's not the variants I want to talk to you about. Aside from there being a lot of foreign editions that I personally like, we got to talk about the German editions. Specifically 3 of them, because yeah, they did 3 different versions. Mm-hmm. 2 of them are embossed. 1 is white and 1 is blue. And it looks really cool. It's kind of hard to tell what you're looking at, but when you figure it out, especially if you see it in person, it is pretty stunning. But hit them with the like heat cover.
So again, those of you 80s kids who remember Genera Hypercolor, the shirt that changed colors when you touched it.
Oh, dude, I have shoes like that.
I know. We have a color-changing comic book. Yes.
Oh, I was wondering what the thermal color edition limited to 400 copies were. But yeah, I used to have a shoe, and I would sit in class, and I would just push on it on the side. And that's what it is. It's like probably got to be a thick comic.
And they made a comic book out of it that actually changed color when you touched it. And it happens to be Spawn number 9, first appearance of Angela and Cagliostro and Medieval Spawn.
And they also coupled that with Spawn issue 11. How thick is this thing?
Oh my gosh, it's got to be ridiculously thick. I want one now.
It's so thick. All right, and let's chat about number 6 on the list.
Number 6 on the list, we have New Teen Titans number 23. This is the first appearance of Blackfire, who happens to be Starfire's sister. And if you were paying attention to DC fandom, you know that she is supposed to be showing in the new series of the Titans.
HBO Max heating up. Pretty exciting, but that's not all. This is the first appearance of Adrian Chase, who will later become Vigilante.
Double key. And then we just found out that Chris Conrad is being cast as Vigilante to play across from the Peacemaker in the HBO Max series.
1,500% increase in copies sold over this last week.
Wow.
All right, dude, let's take a look at number 5 on the list because I was super excited to see it make the top 20 on Key Collector Comics. Use that code TOM101, get access to the full list, and unlock a 1-week subscription of the best comic app around. But I saw some Savage Dragon make the list. Eric Larson, goodness, got all excited. Issue number 253, the election cover B variant.
So this book has been selling incredibly fast, 400% increase, and there are solid sales on eBay in the $25 to $30 range.
Dude, I freaking love Eric Larson. This dude, he always speaks his mind. He was writing about COVID just a couple months ago, and right now he's like, really making his voice heard. I just saw the second print to this issue where they changed the word bubbles. He's really like sharing his opinion. But I always find it interesting. He doesn't ever really get any hate. And I love that because he's been doing it for so long that I think overall, we all like collectively say, he can do whatever he wants.
Well, Eric Larson's been doing this. He's one of those creators, kind of like Todd McFarlane, that has had his character for 25 plus years, and he's just going to continue doing what he's doing and doesn't really care what anyone thinks about it.
All right, dude. I love political comics. You got Red Sarah over there for a reason. I don't know if anyone's ever noticed that, but it's been there forever. Dude, I love me some Barack the Barbarian. Where are my... like, what? Give me some others. There's so many different political comics.
Oh, there's a bunch of them. I mean, Blue Water was releasing John McCain and, you know, Joe Biden comics. I mean, we have a bunch of comics that have come out. There was the Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez comic that came out last year.
Recall? Yeah, that was pretty cool, too.
We just know that every 4 years or so, there are going to be some comic book creators that release these comics, and they don't really have a whole lot of longevity.
But they're dope, though. Like, the Spawn, remind me what happened with the Spawn one, because I know that at one point it kind of sold a pretty good amount, but I like the book. I think it's freaking hilarious. Oh, it's like a Watchmen homage.
That's right, Tom. Spawn number 223 happened to have a Watchmen homage, which I love, but it's even crazier because there was two different variants. One said Mitt Romney wins, one says Barack Obama wins, and people were supposed to pick which one they wanted. Well, you know, everyone bought both copies. So it was so popular. Everyone loved this book, but they're just not selling for a whole lot right now.
It's just so weird to see like such a dope homage, and it's like technically an error to a degree, but it's not an error.
Right, right. Any of the Mitt Romney wins Watchmen covers, I love them.
I think they're really great. I always loved that book, but we got to take a look at the list here at number 4 because I'm getting super hyped about the spec that's starting to pay off, it seems like. We have Darth Vader, issue number 3, the first appearance of Dr. Aphra. $75 average is 9.8s hitting $270. And we are seeing rumors that Disney Plus, they are looking for someone to play a lead protagonist, a female who is going to be someone who is going to be a kind of akin to an Indiana Jones style narrative. Someone's going to be doing a lot of hunting, treasure hunting. Who does it sound like?
Oh, it sounds exactly like Dr. Aphra, who happens to be an archaeologist.
There you go. Now people are getting even more reason to back this comic book. The La Roca variant is definitely one that people are after. It's been on the hot list many times. Mm-hmm. It's given more reason to why people are buying this comic book.
Well, you also have to keep in mind that there is a second, third, and an extra scarce fourth print of this.
The purple variant, the background. Who knew that it would be so scarce and so wanted, hitting $625 at a 9.8?
Like, wow.
Way outdoing the cover, eh?
Oh, yeah.
All right. Now, hit me with number 3, because Key Collector Comics broke some news this week that has got people buzzing like crazy.
Number 3 on the list, we have Department of Truth number 1. James Tynion IV is doing such an incredible job, and this book had buzz before it came out. People were really, really digging all of the variants that they had. They decided to slip in a secret variant on it. But this last week, when I got a notification from Key Collector, everything went crazy.
That's right. People's jaw dropped. Let me read you this update. Inside sources tell Key Collector that a high-dollar bidding war has ended for an ultra-relevant conspiracy theory story, Department of Truth. There is tons of interest on this project that is attracting A-level talent for this movie. 700% increase in copies sold in the last 7 days. This comic is really new. $10 average sales and climbing.
Keep in mind that this book came out a little over a month ago, and there was also a secret variant. It was a 1 in 10 variant with Lee Harvey Oswald on the cover. People didn't know that that was going to be coming out, and it spiked. That's going for about $30 right now.
At the list at number two now, dude, let's welcome Darkhawk back on here.
You know, last time we talked about this character, Darkhawk, I think a lot of people were thinking about the Marvel Age, his actual first appearance. But Darkhawk number one has been the butt of so many internet jokes. There's actually a Facebook group where people consistently show how many copies of Darkhawk number one they have, talking about their retirement fund. Well, laugh no more, because we actually have positive news that is driving sales of this book. $20 average sale and $260 for a CGC 9.8 with a 600% increase in copies sold. That's a lot.
So what's going on? There must be some news. Well, Bleeding Cool was reporting that Marvel has purchased trademarks from the Dark Hawk franchise. Could we see him crossing over to the Marvel Cinematic Universe? Who knows? But there's been a lot of people, as you mentioned, for like nearly 30 years who have been hoping so. And he's a cool character, so why not?
He absolutely is, and he's such a fan favorite. People also need to keep in mind that the last issue of the run that came out in 1995, issue number 50, is a super low print run. That is the one that a lot of people are looking for, and it is just scarce.
Traditionally, those last issues are really, really expensive. Have you seen the static last issues as of late? They're climbing like crazy.
Oh, yeah, they're impossible to find.
All right, before we hit number one on the list, Comic Fam, you only got one more day to join the Mystery Mail Call. It's your way to support the show. We send you comic books. It's a win-win-win because you actually get a Power Rangers 55 guaranteed in the box, the Raph Grissetti Green Ranger variant.
Link in the description. Join the community.
The number one trending comic this week. We foreshadowed it earlier. We're talking Adrian Chase taking on the role as the Vigilante in Teen Titans Annual number 2.
So we've been talking about Vigilante for a very, very long time. And, well, it's not exactly the way that we thought it was going to happen, but
it's happening.
We're right. It was actually Vigilante. We know Vigilante is going to happen. So Teen Titans Annual number 2, first appearance of Vigilante in costume, $25 average sale, high sale of $182 for a CGC 9.8, 2,067% increase this week for a book that we've been talking about over a year because we've been thinking Vigilante was going to be in the universe, but it wasn't Idris Elba.
That's right. We thought it was going to be Idris Elba, but here's the thing. Those rumors, I'm thinking, were likely about the Peacemaker HBO show that was just thrown down and surprising everybody weeks after DC fandom.
Right.
So, yeah, we were thinking Vigilante would be in Suicide Squad, but it makes sense because Vigilante and Peacemaker actually team up in the Vigilante run, and they do it in the most absurd and epic way possible.
We're on a plane that's getting hijacked, and we're both superheroes.
That's right, man.
Let's fight some crime. I mean, come on. That's awesome.
This story is so absurd. They both happened to be on the plane during a hijacking. Literally grenades and guns falling from the overhead compartment. But you know what? Adrian Chase reclaims the mantle in this issue because, you know, he's taking a little break at that time and he needed Peacemaker to bring it out of him because Peacemaker is going to find peace no matter what, no matter how many people he's got to kill.
The 1980s were such a classic time. Now you can't even get shampoo through carry-on, and somehow someone got grenades and guns into their carry-on to be able to put in the compartment. This is crazy.
Well, and Peacemaker has that huge gun, too. I mean, all right, well, look out for that Vigilante 36. I love this issue. And, as always,
geek responsibly.
Enough said. Comic Fam, we have other videos for you to watch. And, dude, show them the Overstreet. Remember a couple, like, top tens ago, I threw the Overstreet because I want to bring the heat? It broke.
This is not geeking responsibly. You really need to take care of your price guide, Tom. I am offended.